Elvis and Priscilla. To the world, it seemed like a love story pulled right from the pages of a fairy tale. A love story only imaginable in a dream.
You couldn't have a more perfect couple than Elvis and Priscilla Presley.
It looked like he was marrying a mirror image of himself.
He said, it's like almost everything I've ever looked for in a woman.
But every fairy tale has a dark side, and every dream can become a nightmare.
He expected her to, you know, be locked up within the gates of Graceland while he went out and cavorted around the world.
When she sort of became independent and fell in love with someone else, it killed him.
He wanted this guy dead. At one time, he wanted him dead. He tried to convince me to kill him. And he told Red to get a hitman to kill him when I wouldn't go do it.
Request Audiobooks presents Elvis, The King Revealed. Program 6, Elvis and Priscilla. Narrated by Henry Stevens and featuring Joe Esposito, Charlie Hodge, Anita Wood, George Barris, Jerry Schilling, George Klein, Sandy Bassett, and others.
Well, it's the one for the money.
At the height of Elvis Presley's young career, he was drafted into the U.S. Army and sent to Germany. His family, his films, and his music were thousands of miles away. Just as it had at the beginning of his career, his life changed before his very eyes. But Elvis would see one more change before he was out of the Army, a change that would affect the rest of his life. Just a few towns over from where he was stationed, 14-year-old Priscilla Beaulieu and her family had just moved in.
Elvis first met Priscilla in Germany. She was stationed in Wiesbaden, Germany. Her father, Colonel Beaulieu, was Major Beaulieu at that time, was there with his family, and Priscilla was there. Cary Grant, his name was Curry, not Cary Grant. Cary Grant was this, he was in the Air Force, and Curry knew Priscilla from the base. And he told Elvis he wanted to bring this young lady to meet him.
You're listening to Joe Esposito.
So one evening, I happen to be there. Curry brings in Priscilla, beautiful, dark-haired young lady, in this like little sailor dress. I mean, she was shocked when she walked in the door. This house with all these men, just a couple of girls. Well, anybody, when you first time meet Elvis Presley, is in awe anyhow of him, so it's understandable.
Charlie Hodge.
He went over and said, hello, I'm Elvis Presley. I swear, that's what he'd do when somebody new came in. You know, he was always friendly.
They talked a little bit, and he took it to the side, and they sat down and visited two of them for a little while. And, you know, we sort of left them alone because, you know, I mean, she had to be nervous. I mean, none of us knew she was 14 years old at the time because she looked maybe 16.
That first meeting with Priscilla was something else. Like I said, he was just enraptured. And when she left that evening, that's what's over there, he looked at me and he said, Charlie, did you see the structure of her face? He said, it's like almost everything I've ever looked for in a woman.
Curry took her home that evening and asked Elvis, would he like to see her again? And they communicated back and forth. Yeah, and she'd come over and visit once in a while. Somebody would go down and pick her up and bring her back and visit and hang out, go to movies.
Her father allowed as long as she was brought over there at a certain time and brought home by a certain time.
Here's author Pat H. Broski.
I believe that Priscilla Beaulieu came along at a very important period in Elvis Presley's life. His mother had recently died. You know, there's a huge hole in his life and a hole in his heart. And along comes this beautiful young woman, and who does bear a bit of a resemblance to the young Gladys Presley. I don't think there's any question about that.
Elvis Priscilla spent a lot of time after he met her in Germany. I mean, not all the time, because he was still in the Army, and during the week it was tough. On weekends, she would come over, hang out with Elvis, and the two of them would spend a lot of time alone. So it was, in the Army days, it was getting to know her, more or less, getting to understand her. And like I say, she was only 14. So what went on between the two of them, alone, together, I don't know, because I wasn't there at the time. But they got to know each other a little better.
By March of 1960, Elvis's Army days were over. As he prepared for his return to the United States, Priscilla begged Elvis to consummate their love the night before he left, but Elvis declined, saying, "Someday we will, Priscilla, but not now." He gave her his sergeant stripes and combat jacket to fill his absence.
They did not have real sex until their honeymoon night. And I would believe that. Elvis was an old-fashioned type of guy. He didn't believe in that before he got married. And that's my story from the other half. Elvis, I never asked Elvis that, but that's what Priscilla told me, and I believe it.
The day Elvis left Germany, reporters caught Priscilla's emotional farewell to the king, sparking rumors that shot back to the States before Elvis even arrived. No one was more surprised by the rumors than Anita Wood, Elvis's girlfriend in Memphis.
I had read a little bit about Priscilla in the papers, and he assured me that this was a child, a 14-year-old child that was the daughter of an army officer.
Anita saw the article in the paper about Priscilla saying goodbye to Elvis as he left, and you know, naturally she asked him about it. And he said, "Oh no, just a young lady that I knew over there," and he sort of, you know, got away from it.
Elvis tried his best to quiet the gossip about his personal affairs in Germany, but it did little good.
There have been a lot of rumors about your love life. Did you meet anyone special in Germany?
Not any special one. There was a little girl that I was seeing quite often over there that her father was in the Air Force, and actually they only got over there about 2 months before I left. I was seeing her, and she was at the airport when I left, and there were some pictures made of her, but it was no big romance. I mean, the stories came out, the girl he left behind, and all that. It wasn't like that. I mean, I had to be careful when I answer a question.
He missed Priscilla. I mean, he really did, and I think that's when they talked back and forth from Germany and Memphis, and I think it's like anything. When you're away from somebody, you miss them more than you see them all the time.
Elvis secretly began planning his future with Priscilla while continuing to date Anita Wood. It wasn't until Anita found a letter from Priscilla that she realized the innocent teenage crush was actually a full-fledged love affair.
In the letter, it said, "Please call my dad. I want to come over there, and if you call my dad, I know he will let me come. He will listen to you. I miss you. I want to come bad." You just kept on like that, you know? So when he came in, I said, "What is this letter? Who is this? This Priscilla? You said she was just a child." I didn't want to talk to him. I didn't want to talk. But he kept calling, and I remember when he got on the phone, "Little, please don't tell anybody about this." He said, "This girl, she's a 14-year-old child, means absolutely nothing." You know, oh boy. And she just wants to visit, it means nothing. And if you told him, I'd get in a lot of trouble, she's so young.
In 1962, nearly 2 years after Elvis left Germany, Priscilla finally got her chance to see the king again. After producing a daily itinerary and a first-class ticket, Priscilla's parents approved a 2-week visit to stay with Elvis over Christmas.
Hairdresser Patty Parry.
He was going with Anita, actually, when I first met him. But she was in Memphis, you know, and he was in California. And Priscilla came over, and I was there, and she came in, and Elvis asked me to take her upstairs and help her, show her the bathroom, help her fix her hair and stuff.
The women he was with over the years, he was really a one-woman man. Because it was Anita Wood, and then he wanted Priscilla coming over there, and when that started happening, when Anita was out and nobody else.
George Barris.
This young man brought this wonderful girl that he really loved in from overseas, and we went to the party he had up at his home in Bel Air, and all the gang was there and all the rock and rollers and everything like that. But he was so respectful of her. He says, "Now, I don't want you staying here with me. Yes, I would like to have you go with my dear friends Shirley and George Barris and stay with him when you're here in town. And when I get ready to go for dinner and things like that, I'll come over and pick you up with the limousine." And that's just what he did. He was that kind of a person. He was truly thoughtful and considerate of the people and people around him, and mostly of Priscilla, that she was in good care.
Elvis had all of the girls that used to hang out at the house, you know, the regulars, and they would sit down in the den, and he said, look, I met this little girl in Germany, and I'm bringing her over here, and I'm really serious, and the parties are going to stop. And the parties did stop, actually.
After a slew of late-night social bashes, a near overdose from Elvis's sleeping pills, and then a drunken New Year's Eve party, 16-year-old Priscilla returned to Germany more in love with Elvis than ever. They still had not made love by any traditional standard, and Priscilla began to suspect that Elvis was not as faithful as he insisted.
Elvis was still seeing other ladies, too, at the time. Okay, Elvis, as we all know, loved women, to be around women, his companionship, not necessarily just for sexual things or anything like that, just he loved being around women.
Girlfriend Sandy Farrah Martindale.
He liked a certain kind of a girl, and in a lot of ways we were alike. We were both kind of quiet and demure, sort of, in a way, back then. I'm not now, I'm a big mouth, I talk a lot. But I was very quiet then and kind of shy, and he liked that. And we were about the same age, and we were built kind of the same. And he said some things earlier on when Priscilla was in Germany. He said some things to my mom in regards to, you know, the wanting me to move in. And he said some things that leads you to believe. I mean, he didn't want me to go to college because he didn't want a girl to be smarter than him. But ultimately, Priscilla was cuter and she got him, so what can I tell you?
Elvis and Priscilla maintained their relationship over the phone for several months until Elvis realized he could no longer live without her. He called Priscilla's parents and begged them to let her move to Memphis under his guidance. They reluctantly agreed.
She was still very young, and so the deal was that she would stay with Elvis's parents. And he would see that she went to school, which she did. She got a good education. And I don't believe he ever touched her till they were married.
When she first came to Graceland, and she was living with Elvis's father and stepmother, she didn't come in and move right into Graceland. But as time went on, little by little, she started moving her stuff in there. But it was trying to keep down, not make a big thing out of it, because she was young. And little by little, you know, they were seen together, they traveled together, we did things together, and it was fine.
Sandy Bassett.
We had such wonderful times there, going to the theaters, go to the amusement park. I mean, it was all late at night, but he had no choice, he had no other choice to enjoy life but to do it with his intimate friends. And we used to have these great New Year's parties that were so fun, New Year's Eve parties. Yeah, we'd all go down and then Elvis and Priscilla would come down to the club, you know, and celebrate with us.
Bill Medley of the Righteous Brothers.
I was at Graceland for a couple of days and I walked in and I think Priscilla opened the door and her hair was light brown, I believe, and up in a bun or something. And I just had never seen anybody that gorgeous. She just was absolutely stunning.
I don't know, I figured when she moved in there that that's a pretty good anchor. You know, that's kind of like staking your territory and laying your claim.
Priscilla eventually graduated from Immaculate Conception, a Catholic all-girls school, and her relationship with Elvis grew into more of an adult love. They attempted to lead a normal life between his films, but dating Elvis proved anything but normal.
Elvis used to rent the theater to see movies that he wanted to see. So he says, Bill, we're going down, you know, to see some movies. I said, well, cool. And so we get out to the limousine. He says, Bill, you get in the back. I said, oh, well, okay. And Elvis and Priscilla got in the front. And we drove out down to the front gate, and there was like, I don't know, 75, 150 people. They see that limousine come, they start screaming, and everybody looked in the back, thinking Elvis is going to be in the back, and it's me, and then I'm waving it, and nobody looked in the front, and we just drove right off to the theater.
Well, we have some great stories about Elvis. All the gang got together, Chief and Joe and all, and they said, well, this is Christmas time. Elvis said, well, what can I give to my guys for Christmas? And they all said, well, let's vote on all having Eldorado convertibles. So here I am out there searching for about 7 or 8 Eldorado convertibles, and then I had to ask everybody, well, what color do you want? You want red, you want green, you want blue? And well, Priscilla was, she got into the groove. She liked pink. So the motorcycle we created for her was a pink with pearl and different pinstriping and her initials in the right way, and same way with her cars. So she got involved with the car action and motorcycles with him just as much to show you how much she appreciated being a part of his life too.
Priscilla and I used to go horseback riding in Memphis. We'd go to the stables and rent horses with, you know, some of her friends. A bunch of us would go down and rent horses. And so we had a common bond there where we loved horses.
Jerry Schilling.
You know, that whole thing started, it was around Christmas time, and he said he wanted to get Priscilla a horse for Christmas. And would I mind if he bought Sandy a horse and they could ride together? And I said, no, man, she'd love it. So he said, okay, let's go out and look for horses.
He bought Priscilla a horse and myself a horse, and had it waiting outside, you know, the back gate of the pasture. And he said, I have a surprise for you. And he had Scylla's Domino. She named him Domino. And then my horse. And because of those two horses, it started his love and his desire to get horses for everybody. I mean, it started something that was just incredible. It went from Graceland with two horses.
And then he and I got one, and that was the first 4 horses. And then, of course, we wound up with 37 horses and a ranch. It was a real great camaraderie type of thing, you know. Just not just to ride the horses, but even though it was in the back of Graceland, it seemed like another world. And nailing up, you know, he had everybody's name on their stall and the horse's name.
He said, Daddy's. He didn't say Vernon's, but Daddy's. Priscilla's, mine.
We used to come to Hawaii and stayed in Kailua at a house that he rented. It was a dead-end street, and Elvis rented the house right at the dead end of that street. But being in Hawaii with everybody, we just hung out at the beach. We didn't do much of anything except stay there, enjoy the beach and the swimming pool, and I don't believe we really ventured out much to go sightseeing. We just hung out on Kalaka Street. That's what it was. Priscilla and I were real good friends. We spent a lot of time together. I mean, she was a sweetheart, and I really believe that she and Elvis were made for one another. Yeah, they had a special relationship.
Elvis styled Priscilla's hair the way he wanted, dressed her in the colors and clothes he chose, and even did her makeup the way he liked. She became Elvis's doll for him to show off by his side. She started tagging along with him when he went to Los Angeles to begin a new film, partly out of loneliness, and partly to keep an eye on him around certain female co-stars about whom rumors began to arise.
George Klein.
Before they start a motion picture in Hollywood, usually the stars meet and they go over a few things, and they do the wardrobe test, and they do the still picture test. And at that meeting, Elvis and Ann Margaret became very friendly, but while they were making the movie, Viva Las Vegas, they were very, very close, if you know what I mean.
Makeup man Dan Strebicki.
It was Viva Las Vegas with Ann Margaret, and boy, what a hot pair. And I said to Elvis one morning, in fact, at the Sahara Hotel, I used to go up to his room and make him up. And I said, that's a match for you. And I don't know what I should say this or not. He said, wait till you meet Priscilla.
Viva Elvis!
He told me, he said, you know why I stopped going to Van? I said, no, why? He said, because I knew I was going to marry Priscilla. So he broke it off himself. You see, he was beginning to feel things for her, and like I said, he knew he was going to marry Priscilla, so he just broke it off before he could go any farther.
Elvis's film career and record sales began slipping during the mid-60s. Poor reviews, coupled with turning 30, caused Elvis to start doubting himself, questioning the very talent that had brought him this far. His arguments with Priscilla grew more heated as a result. He even helped her pack once when she threatened to leave. Priscilla's parents began urging him to finally marry their daughter, as if to complete some contract.
I think that came more or less from Priscilla's parents, saying, hey, you know, it's been with you long enough, it's time to get married. And Elvis had no bones about that, and he was very happy to.
Lance LeGault.
Elvis told me on the set of Speedway he and Priscilla were going to get married, and I said, oh, man, don't tell me no secrets. And I laughed, you know, it was a joke, but I said, don't tell me any secrets. You know, if it gets out, you know, it could be me, you think, or somebody thinks. I said, so don't tell me no secrets. So we finished the day's work, and I'm on the San Diego freeway, and I'm going home. It's about 6:15. It comes on the radio, the announcement that Elvis and Priscilla are going to get married pretty soon. And one thing, and then I said, oh, Jesus, don't tell me. But it was all right, because Colonel Parker called a press conference.
It was official. Elvis, at 32 years of age, would take Priscilla, now 21, to be his wife in a private ceremony on March 1, 1967, at the Aladdin Hotel in Las Vegas. So private, in fact, that most of the Memphis Mafia were excluded.
By Friday, I guess we were told, on Saturday, a car will pick you up at your home at a certain hour, and the car picks us up, takes us to the airport, and only when we get to the airport and are given tickets do we know we're going to Las Vegas. And someone, one of the other young people around, said, oh, you know, I just have a feeling Elvis is getting married. And I said, oh, no, no way. So we got there, we went to the back entrance of the Aladdin. At that point, I did not know there were hundreds of press inside, you know, camping out on the floors because word had gotten out. I knew about it because I was driving the Colonel to Palm Springs. And a lot of the guys thought I was going to Palm Springs, and we really were going to Vegas. The Colonel set that up at the Aladdin Hotel. They'd set up one room to be it, and it was just room enough for the immediate families and Joe and Marty as best men.
They weren't allowed to come into the ceremony itself because the apartment was not big enough. And some of them were very much offended that they couldn't come into the ceremony.
Producer Matt Simber.
Actually, I was a drop-in guest. My ex-wife and I were in Vegas, and we saw the Colonel the night before. And he said, come on over to the Aladdin tomorrow. We're having a bash. Elvis is getting married. But the astounding thing that I remember about the wedding was that many of the people that were there had never really seen Priscilla in person. And when she entered, came down the aisle, and she turned toward Elvis, she lifted her veil, and they were both side view of the two looking at each other. And what was amazing was that they looked exactly alike. It looked like he was marrying a mirror image of himself.